Ok. So, last time, we introduced the notion of module category and exact module category. So let me recall that what is an exact module category. So as I wrote last time, let C be a multi-tensor category with enough projective objects. A C module category is called exact if for all projective objects in C and for all elements in the module M, then P tensor M is also projective. So this is what I said. Let me check. Okay. And we stated that a semi-simple module category is exact. And we said that if the multi-tensor category is semi-simple, then for a module to be exact, it's equivalent for being semi-simple. Okay. And then we stated the first property for exact module category. So we said that that if you have an exact module category M, which has finitely many simple objects, then it is finite, the finite abelian category. We said also that in an exact C module category, any projective object is injective and vice versa, which means that an exact C module category is a quasi-Frobenius category. Okay. So today, we will first continue by stating some properties for exact module category. And then we will talk about module category and Z plus module at the fusion ring level. And finally, we will open a new section about algebra in multi-tensor category, so algebra object, which will be very interesting. So let me finish by stating some properties of some other properties of exact module category. Categories. Okay. So this property will be about, so we will consider an exact C module category and we will consider the set of simple objects. And we will make a decomposition of the module category according to some equivalence on the simple object. And this will be a kind of complete reducibility property for exact module category. So let me explain that in more details. So complete reducibility property for exact C module category. So let M be an exact C module category okay, let big O of M be the set of simple object in M up to isomorphism. be the set of simple objects. In M up to isomorphism. So we will make an equivalence relation on this set. Consider the following equivalence relation. So it's an exercise to show that it is really an equivalence relation on this set. So you take two elements in this set. Then there is a relation between the two if and only if Y is a subquotient of L tensor X for some L, so module product. So X is a subquotient of L module product X for some L in C. It's an exercise to show that this really define an equivalence relation. So now you will consider the partition according to this relation. B, the partition induced by this relation, which means that two elements are in the same component if and only if they are equivalent according to that. Then we will generate, so let Mi be the full subcategory of M generated by the is component, be the full subcategory of M generated. We will explain a bit what I mean by generated by that. So let me write like that. So generated mean consisting of object whose simple subquotient are in this set. Subquotient lies in subquotient. Are in this set up to isomorphism, of course. Up to isomorphism. Okay. So that will be the component of for the decomposition. Of the C module category. So this MI is a C module subcategory of M. subcategory of M. It is exact. And we have the expected decomposition I of MI. The expected decomposition. Complete reducibility property for exact C module category. Okay. Okay. So the MI is indecomposable and called the component, so R, if you prefer. So each MI is indecomposable and called a component component of M. Now let me write it like that, because they are all, each component is of this form. So M I are indecomposable and called the components of M. Okay. So another property for exact C module category. Let M N be two C module category. Assume. So what? Let me say what is it about. So one is of the two is exact. Then any additive module functor is exact. That we will state a property which will be used, which may be used later to see that it's a way to characterize exact module category. So it's a, this property will be used to characterize exact module category. So you have two C module category, but only M is exact, is assumed to be exact. Then any additive module functor F from M to N is exact. And as I said, we may see, I don't know if you will see that in details or not, that it is a way to characterize exact module category. Characterize exact module category. Okay. So now, what about module category, but at the ring level? So you have, when you have a tensor category, a fusion category, you have a fusion ring. When you have a multi-tensor category, you have a Z plus ring. But when you have a C module category, what do you have at the level of ring? You have what is called Z plus module over the over the Z plus ring associated to the category C. So you have the module category provide a Grothendieck group, which is a Z plus module on the Grothendieck ring of the multi-tensor category. Okay. Let me write that. Let me recall first the notion of Z plus module over Z plus ring. And then let me state the relation with a C module category. So module category and Z plus module. As I said, let us first recall quickly, don't worry, the notion of Z plus module. So let A be a Z plus ring so very briefly. Z plus ring is what? They exist B equal B I included in A basis. You have B I B J equal sum of C I J K B K. With Cijk non-negative. With Cijk Z plus, which is just like that. And you have also an extra, the unit element decompose positively. AI turn than equal to zero. Okay. So this is a Z plus ring. And the Z plus module Z plus module over Z plus ring A. Is a so it's a module as a ring. So it's a module A module M. Again, you have a basis, and you have a specific constant structure for the action of the basis B of A to the basis of M. So we have a fixed basis. M L L in some set L such that B I M L equal to the sum for K in L A I L K M K with A I L K in Z plus. So this Z plus module is called indecomposable. If it is not a non-trivial direct sum of Z plus module. A non-trivial direct sum of Z plus module. So it is called irreducible if, as you can expect, if it has no proper Z plus submodule. Submodule. Okay. So that's all for the recall. So let me come back to category theory. Okay. So let C be a multi-tensor category. So we will state a proposition about the Grothendieck ring of a C-module category to be a Z plus module over the Grothendieck group, sorry, of a Z plus of a C module category to be a Z plus module over the Grothendieck ring of C. Proposition. Let M be a wow. What? Be a C module category. Then the Grothendieck group GRM is a Z plus module over the Grothendieck ring RC. Okay. So, moreover, so here M is not assumed to be exact, but if it is exact and indecomposable, then its Grothendieck group is also indecomposable over the Grothendieck ring of C. If, moreover, M is exact and indecomposable, then the Grothendieck group of M is also indecomposable over the Grothendieck ring of C. So you said you can think, you can say, okay, what is the point of assuming exact? Because we, in fact, the point is that if you don't assume exact, then it's not true in general. False without assuming exact. False, I mean that if you don't assume exact, then you cannot, you have counter example in which an indecomposable C module don't have an indecomposable Grothendieck group over the Grothendieck ring of C. So you have a counter example in the book. I chose to do not mention it because it was a bit it was not so trivial. not complicated, but anyway. I wanted to go fast. So, and in fact, so in this case, it is indecomposable, but in fact, it's more than that. It is irreducible. Is an irreducible Z plus module over the quadratic ring of C. Okay. Okay. So that's all for module category, exact module category. Now we will go to an important new section called algebra in multi-tensor category. And we will see that we will see relation between algebra in a multi-tensor category and module category. So the category of homomorphism of A module with A an algebra object we will define now will be, let me check, a left C module category. But we are far from this proposition. So let me introduce the notion of algebra in a multi-tensor category, which is fundamental. Algebra in a multi-tensor category. In a multi-tensor category. So very important, very, very important. Particular for me, I come from a subfactor theory. A subfactor can be define a fusion category. In fact, you can come back to the subfactor. The subfactor is given by the Frobenius algebra. Some algebra object in the fusion category. So I am specifically interested in such algebra object. So let me state that. Let me state that motivation. Subfactor. So for people who are comfort know about subfactors, otherwise you just forget what I am saying. That say finite index, finite depth. Provide two fusion category. So anyway, let me provider. The fusion. Fusion category. So the subfactor M inside M of NN by module. So as I said, don't worry about that. Just and you end. And we can come back or and the subfactor planar algebra, let's say, is completely determined by an algebra object on C. In fact, Frobenius algebra, more precisely. No. Frobenius algebra. Anyway, it is just for people who follow the course I gave semester before about subfactor and subfactor plan algebra. And about so second motivation two. So we will define. So after the definition of algebra object. Algebra object in a multi-tensor category. Category. Algebra object et multi-tensor category. We will define the notion of a module and of a module homomorphism providing defining a new category called denoted mod C A. Which is a C module category. So you see here the connection with the previous section about module category. So you have an algebra object we will define now. We define the notion of a module of this algebra and a module homomorphism that will be the object and the morphism of a new category denoted mod CA, which is a C module category. Okay. So what is the definition of an algebra object? So I will need to draw some nice speech diagram. And this is really interesting, in fact, the notion of algebra object, because this will be a categorification of the notion of algebra. When you take the multi-tensor category to be VEC, then an algebra object is just define an associative algebra, a usual algebra, if you want, associative algebra with unit. But if the multi-tensor category is not VEC, some general multi-tensor category, in particular, without a representation as a set, then you can still define a notion of algebra. So we can define then by the powerfulness of category theory, you can generalize the notion of algebra beyond the set. And that's very interesting. So let's see, be a multi-tensor category. So definition algebra object. So an algebra or algebra object, in fact, in C. So what is an algebra in C? So it's given by the triple is a triple when A will be an object, M will encode them, will correspond to the multiplication, and U correspond to the unit. So is a triple A M U where A is an object. So it's not a vector space, it's not even a set in general, it's just an object in some multi-tensor category. But it's no set structure here. M. So it's a morphism from A, tensor A to A. So C is a multi-tensor category, so you have a tensor structure. Will correspond to the multiplication. But you see, it's not a multiplication between, it's not defined by multiplication of two elements in a set. It's just a morphism from A tensor A to A. There is no object, there is no element. And U is a morphism from the unit to A. And this corresponds to the unit of the algebra. So they are both are morphism, just morphism. So just an arrow in the graph corresponding to the category C. Of course, it should satisfy some commuting diagram, and you will see this commuting diagram will look like what you can expect for the usual algebra. Such that the following diagram commutes. So you will have one diagram for associativity of the multiplication and two diagrams for the properties of the unit with respect to the multiplication. So first diagram. The first diagram is the more important. The second one is important also. So you start from A tensor. A. So A is just an object in the category. So you can apply the associativity constraint here to move the parenthesis. That's usual, no problem. Now, here, you apply the multiplication morphism here or here, and identity morphism on the right. So M tensor IDA or IDA tensor M. And you go to A tensor A, A tensor A. And then you can apply again the morphism M. This encode the associativity of the multiplication. If the multi-tensor category C is just vec, then A is an algebra and that just corresponds to the associativity. Associativity of the multiplication. Okay. Okay, so what about unit? So one tensor A. So you apply the unit constraint LA. Go to A. Or you apply the unit morphism on one and identity on A. And you get to A tensor A. And then you apply the multiplication, get to A. And here you apply the identity of A. So that should commute. And you have the same for the right multiplication by one, A tensor one. So the unit constraint for the right, you apply ID A tensor U, A tensor A. You apply M to A ID A. And it's also commutative diagram. And this is properties of unit with respect to the multiplication. Multiplication. Okay. As I said, A is a associative constraint, L and R are the unit constraint. Associativity and unit constraints as usual, for the usual one. Okay, so we will take the pause. Pause. Okay, so as I said, If you take the multi-tensor category C to B, just the trivial one, VEC, and what is defined above is exactly the definition of an associative finite dimensional algebra with unit. If you take VEC to be the category of finite dimensional vector space. Remark. When C equals VEC, category of finite dimensional vector space. So as usual, we assume it's over the field K. So the field K is fixed. It's not written, it's assumed. So we get the definition of an associative finite dimensional algebra with unit. As I said, more is strong enough to extend the notion of algebra beyond cette théorie. Well, let's say beyond cette. Which is very good. Very good. Okay. So now, what about example of algebra in a multi-tensor category? So let me write the basic example of algebra in a multi-tensor category. You already see one example. If a multi-tensor category is VEC, then an algebra is just in the categorical sense is an usual algebra. But there are some even more trivial examples. So in a multi-tensor category C, the unit object is an algebra object. The multi-tensor category C, the unit object 1C is an algebra. Algebra object. In the book, I just write algebra, but sometimes I like to write algebra object to. Wow. Sorry. So what happened? Am I still on? Okay, so it should be okay. Oh, yeah. Okay. Okay, so sorry. I just pressed the wrong button on my iPad. Okay, so the unit object is an algebra object. So it's completely trivial. You can check the axiom, the diagram. What about with group? So what about rep G and vec G? So the algebra function on a finite group is an algebra object on rep G, which means that the algebra function is a representation of G and is also an algebra. And it's an algebra object in the category rep G. So the algebra of function. So this is a usual algebra, but with an additional. So if you take C equal vec, an algebra object is an algebra. If you take some other category which are set like a representation, you still get an algebra with some additional structure. Here you should get an algebra. An algebra object in rep G should be an algebra which is a representation. So here it's an example, vec, the algebra of function. But we will see later algebra objects which are not set. So the algebra of function on a finite group G with values in some in the ground, some ground field. Okay. Is an algebra object of rep G. So which means that it's an object in rep G. So it's a representation of the group where the group acts by right translation. Okay, now you put an example for rep G. Now what about vec G? An algebra in vec G. So an algebra in vec is just a usual algebra. An algebra in vec G is a usual algebra, which is G graded. Is a G graded algebra. For example, if L is a subgroup of G, subgroup, then this algebra of L, the algebra KL, is an algebra in vec G. In vec G. So you can take L equal G, of course. So you see here what we call function of G is sometime you can see it denoted like that, K power G. So you should see K power G here and KL or KG particular. So KL, KG is the correspond to vec G and K and that K power G correspond to vec G. K power G is the usual algebra analogous of vec G and K, c'est KG, KG KG is the usual algebra analogous of RepG. So you see here that in some sense, VecG is an algebra on RepG and RepG is an algebra on VecG. In some sense, in a more precise sense, in fact, we will see later that RepG and VecG are more equivalent. So this is also related to this history of Morita equivalence and Drinfeld center. They are the same Drinfeld center. That's why you have so much coincidence between these two categories. Okay, so now let me state the example with VecG omega. Which is not a set here, so more generally. Let omega be a 3 cocycle on G with value in K star. So phi be a 2 cochaine of a subgroup, so you can take L equal G, such that omega is equal to D2 phi. So I don't go into the details of cocycle, cochaine, cohomology theory. I don't want to go into the details of that. Then the twisted KL phi as defined before. So we already defined that. Is an algebra object in vec g omega. And what is interesting here, that is the following remark. So it is associative so let me write the remark here. It is associative in the usual algebra sense if and only if omega is equal to 1, which mean, again, I don't go into the details. I don't even check that phi is a 2 cocycle. So phi is a 2 cochaine. And omega is trivial if and only phi is also a 2 cocycle. So it's associative. If and if omega is trivial, otherwise it's only associative in the categorical sense, but it's not associative in the usual algebra sense. Otherwise, it is only associative in above categorical sense as an algebra object Off avec chip. Okay. So that's funny. That's funny. So if you can you define an algebra object on the category which has no set model, so then you get an algebra object. The algebra object is an algebra which is not necessarily associative as an usual algebra sense, but of course associative in the categorical sense by definition of what is an algebra object in a category. So that's fun. That's funny, interesting. So what about algebra object in the category of co-module of a bi-algebra? Let H be a bi-algebra an algebra object in H commode. So H commode is a notation for the category of commode H commode commodule. So such an algebra object is an algebra A, which is also a H commodule. Okay, but not it's not just that. It's an algebra which is an H commodule such that the commodule map is an algebra homomorphism, which is also a H commodule such that the commodule map A to H A is an algebra homomorphism. Homomorphism. Okay. And why I wrote this example? This example is interesting because you recover fundamental notion in of algebra theory and by algebra theory called the notion of co-ideal subalgebra, which is also interesting for subfactor theory because in the DEF2 irreducible subfactor, intermediate of which correspond to Katz algebra, of algebra with a star structure, the intermediate subfactor correspond to left co-ideal subalgebra. So that's why I'm interested in that. For example, the co-ideal subalgebra of H, an example of such algebra, over the in the H commode, and what is the meaning of co-ideal subalgebra? Co-ideal subalgebra mean voilà. Okay. Co-ideal subalgebra mean subalgebra K in H such that the co-multiplication applied to K is included in H tensor K with delta the co-multiplication. So this is included. Okay, and as I said, let me write what I said about subfactor theory. Uh, for those interested in subfactor theory, for those who come from functional analysis. Remark. So there is a bijective correspondence between irreducible depth two. So again, don't worry about that if you don't understand. Just skip what I am saying in this remark. Irreducible depth two finite index subfactor planar algebra and up to equivalence. And Katz algebra, finite dimensional Katz algebra. Finite dimensional Katz algebra, which means Hopf algebra with star structure and over the field, the complex field. In fact, you have the subfactor n inside m. In fact, in Katz algebra K, you can always write of this form. So m is isomorphic to m point fixed point, or m is isomorphic to n cross product with k. And then it's a theorem. So it's a big remark. Let NPM be an intermediate subfactor. Then P equal M power what? So let me write H to get this good notation. H. Then MP equal AM power H fixed point with K a left coideal subalgebra. Left coideal subalgebra of H. So we came back to what we were interested in. Algebra object in H commode. Example of such algebra object are the coideal subalgebra, which are defined like that. So delta K is included in H tensor K. And the big remark say that for those people interested in functional analysis, operator algebra, and subfactor theory, there is a bijective correspondence between irreducible depth two finite index subfactor planar algebra and included in M and finite dimensional of C star algebra over the fields, over the complex field. And then any intermediate subfactor can be written of this form where K is a left coideal subalgebra, as before. Okay. So if you don't know about that subfactor, you should skip that. Or you should go to some YouTube video about the introductory part of two semester later course, where I introduce the notion of phoneme algebra, surfactor, plane algebra, and quantum arithmetic. Okay. So now, let me state another important example. So let C be a multi-tensor category. And X be some object, not necessarily an algebra object, but some object, an object. Then we will be able to make an algebra object from that as follows. Then the object A equal X tensor X star as a structure of algebra object. Of algebra object. And it's not, it's a kind of generalization of a process. You should know in vector space linear algebra. If you take one vector space V and you take the dual V star, then V tensor V star is isomorphic to the matrix algebra. The algebra is isomorphic to the algebra of linear map from V to itself. And if V is n-dimensional, then it is isomorphic to Mn of C if it is over the complex V. Mn of K if it is over some field K. So this process can be generalized to any multi-tensor category. You need to have a dual structure. Then X tensor X star as a structure of algebra object. So what about the unit and multiplication morphism? The unit and multiplication morphism will be defined using the evaluation and co-evaluation map. And we will draw some picture. Where unit and multiplication, unit U and multiplication M morphism are defined using co-evaluation map, like that. The evaluation map or the co-evaluation map as follows. So, first the unit, it's U, which is equal to just the co-evaluation map of X from 1 to X tensor X star, which is A. So that's okay. The usual picture is like that. X X star. So what about the multiplication? Multiplication. So M will be equal to IDX tensor evaluation map tensor IDX star. And what is the picture for that? You have so let me put this a bit, shift that. You have So like that. X, X star. X, X star. Star. X, X star. So that's it. It. So remember that when you put two pictures like that, if you put this picture and this picture like that, this means you take the tensor product of object. Line corresponds to object. Vertex corresponds to morphism. And when you put two lines, then it corresponds to tensor product. Okay, and then, so what are we doing? We apply identity here, and evaluation map here. So identity mean that we continue, and evaluation map is that. And so you can draw it like that up to isotopy if you want to. X, X star, and that is again A. So you really get a morphism from A tensor A to A. Okay. And so as stated before, if you take so in particular, A equal one, A equals unit, provide an algebra structure on the unit. We already mentioned that as an example. The first example, the unit is an algebra object. But here, one star equal one, and one tensor one star equal one, or isomorphic to one, or equal one, if we make this assumption without loss of generality. So let me draw. I will draw the picture of checking the associativity diagram, the commutation of the associativity diagram. Let me draw the picture for the associativity diagram. So, the associativity diagram of an algebra object is that. So we will draw a picture for that for the example A equal X tensor X star. So let me draw it quickly. So you have A tensor A, parenthesis, tensor A. So you have A tensor A, parenthesis, tensor A. Okay. And then you have the associativity constraint. A, and you get A tensor A. And then you apply the multiplication like that. Identity here. And again, the multiplication. Or, you apply the multiplication on the right, identity here, and again the multiplication. You see that both, they are both equal to equal to, in fact, by up to isotopy, you can just move that here and move that here, and you will get the same diagram. If you move that here or that here, you get the same diagram. Okay, which is equal to ID X composed with evaluation X composed evaluation X composed with ID X star. Is from A tensor, A tensor, A to A. So the diagram commutes. You see, if you go on the issue, you have the commuting diagram, you go like that or like that, and you get the same thing. So the diagram commutes as you can expect. So this is a good example. This example is fundamental. I should say fundamental example. It's not important because the others are also important, but fundamental. You can make an algebra object from any object in a multi-tensor category. In particular, if you take a multi-tensor category which is far from being close to a set, you take any object and you take A tensor X star, X tensor X star, and you get an algebra object, which is an algebra in the categorical sense, which is far from set. Very good. Okay. So I don't want to start a new section. The new section will be about because it remains only 5 minutes, it will be bad to introduce a new section and then I will have no time to introduce that properly. So next time. Next session, we'll introduce the notion of module object over an algebra object. In a multi-tensor category. Module object over an algebra object. So you will have again some diagram. Yeah. And then module homomorphism. Which are object and morphism of a new category mode as mode CA. One algebra object A, tensor category, which is a left C module category. OK. So we will see that next time. OK. See you next. See you later. Okay.